Africa is blessed with natural resources, which are second to none. Africa has vast land area. There's a wide diversity of soil type. There's a wide diversity of climate. There's a wide diversity of agroecoregions. Africa also has very bright, brilliant farmers who know how to do agriculture. Africa has very good scientists. Everything is there. It's a matter of getting all things together and help them translate science into action. And this summit, which is being held here at EECA, is very important in that direction. It's trying to bring the ideas together, trying to develop an agenda, a roadmap, a timetable, and what is required to achieve that timetable. I'm sure that in a matter of 10 to 20 years, Africa can be, will be, should be breadbasket of the world. Science is available. Yes, we do need more science, but whatever is available is not being translated into action. That requires political willpower. Political willpower is very critical to do anything. For example, climate change. The government heads of state go to the climate summit, they make slogans, they make promises, but promises are not fulfilled. The same thing here. Political willpower to translate science into action through policies which are pro-agriculture, pro-farmer, and pro-nature. Make agriculture a respectable profession. Give respect to farmers that they deserve. And make sure that they have access to innovative technology. Make sure the credit is available. Make sure extension services are good enough to help them transfer the knowledge that exists into action. So it's a political part which is very, very critical. And the policymaker, if they get together with academicians and with the private sector, that tripartite relationship can go a long way in fulfilling that dream. One example is that land has soil, has to be treated like a bank account. You cannot keep taking things out of a bank without depositing things into it. Land is the same thing. Soil is the same way, like a bank account. It follows the law of return. The law of return says anything you take from soil, you must return it to the same place from which you have taken. If you do not return, soil gets depleted. Soils of Africa, like soils in the Caribbean, like soils in some of the Central American countries, like soils in the Andean region, soils in South Asia, have been depleted because we take out more than we put it back in. This is an education, and this is where the farmers have to be helped. When the farmers are desperate, and they need crop residue for feeding to the cattle, or building their home, or even worse, cooking food with them, they cannot think of the residue should be returned to the land. Therefore, the policymaker should make sure that their basic necessities are met. Only then they can think about investing into the soil. And this is a thing which we have to make sure that they understand. People, farmers are mirror image of the soil that they live on. When farmers are suffering and miserable and desperate, they pass their suffering to the land, to the soil. And soil reciprocates with poor yield, with poor quality food, with polluted food, and that affects the health of the people. Somewhere we have to make sure that the people understand that the health of soil, plants, animals, people, environment, and the planet is one and indivisible. And this continuity, this connectivity must be respected. This is where the working with farmers, with policymakers, with private sector, so that everybody, that we are all together in it. It's relevant everywhere.
What do you need for that?
Well, soil is a living entity. Soil is a living entity. When soil is dead, it cannot produce. Then it's a dirt. A dead soil is a dirt. A living soil is the only site in the universe at the root-soil interface which has the divine power, if I can put it that way. Scientifically, it has biogeochemical and biogeophysical processes. Religiously, you can call those processes divine power to resurrect death into life. And that is because soil has those life support processes. 25% of all terrestrial biodiversity, all, lives in the soil. So soil life has to be respected. Soil organic matter content, which is a food for the organisms, that must be maintained to 3.5 to 5%. In many depleted, degraded soils of the developing countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa and elsewhere, it is less than 0.25%, 0.5%. And therefore, even when the inputs are made, soil is not responsive for it. So that raises another very important question. If soil is a living entity, does it have a rights like any other living thing has? In my opinion, it should. It must. Simply because you own it does not mean that you can do anything with it. You can dump the chemical as you wish, or you flood it as you like, or you plow it when you want and how you want it, or you use chemical as you wish. No, there's a life in it, and we must be respectful of that life. Fortunately, we have been discussing today the example of Cerrado. In fact, I have seen Cerrados in 1975. It was no different than what is Africa today. See what has happened with the education, with the investment in agriculture, with the respectability of the farming profession. Obviously, more needs to be done. But at the moment, agriculture in Cerrado is better than in the United States. Over 25-year period, it has become the largest exporter of the food. Africa still has the same potential. And we must encourage them, we must motivate them, we must show them the roadmap, and we must let them know that we are with you. We will support you, but they must be committed. They must have willpower. Yes, we will do it. And you have seen me giving them example. China by the same way, India by the same way, Bangladesh by the same way. Over 25 years, they have transformed. Food production has gone more than the rate of population. In fact, in India, the food production since 1950s have gone up by a factor of 6.5. Population has gone up by a factor of 4. Some of the dairy products and horticulture products over the same period have gone up 10 times. More needs to be done, but it certainly has proven Malthusian wrong. So Africa can certainly do the same thing. Now, that does not mean that Africa should not pay attention to reducing the population growth rate. Because right now, population trend is destined to have African population 4.2 billion by 2100, from 1.4 billion now. That should not happen if the women have education, if women have empowerment, so they have control of their own destiny. And I think in addition to translating science into action, we must support women for their education, to empower them, to give them resources so they have control of their own destiny. They will bring the population down. Agra can help facilitate, bring the stakeholders together like they are doing today. They have brought them to the same time, the table for discussion. And they can organize things. They can create the awareness. They can improve the education. They can provide support to farmers through publication, through media. They can encourage stakeholders like Syngenta and Bayer and other organizations that can help farmers receive their inputs. They can motivate policymakers. Today, most of the clients listening on the summit are policymakers. And EECA is doing a great job. They could do the same thing somewhere in Africa, many places. South Africa, Central Africa, Western Africa, Eastern Africa, Horn of Africa, Sahel region, and of course in North Africa. They could have workshops like this everywhere, increase awareness. ECA is a catalytic agent. It can do a lot, and it is doing it. I'm very pleased with what Dr. Otero is doing and his team.